Good morning, everyone. Would you please stand for our call to worship? Please join us as we sing Wonderful, Merciful Savior. Hear this word of the Lord from Psalm 33. Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre. Make melody to him with the harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. This is the word of the Lord. Please join us as we continue to sing. Come behold the wondrous mystery.
Theme of
Please be seated.
Welcome to Lincroft Bible Church. Here at LBC, we are transformed by the gospel. We believe that Jesus changes everything. It also changes who we are as a church. And so as a church, we have four core identities. We are disciples, family, servants, and ambassadors. We are disciples. We are followers of Jesus who are changed by him. We are family. We are adopted sons and daughters of God who love one another like family. We are servants. We serve one another because Jesus has served us best in the gospel. And we are ambassadors. We are Holy Spirit empowered witnesses of Christ in the world. My name is Chris, and one of the pastors here. We're very glad that you're with us this morning. All of our services are built around retelling God's story, that God is holy, we are sinners, Jesus saves us from our sins, and he sends us out on his mission. So I just want to give a special welcome to any of you who are here for the first time or tuning in online for the first time. We're asking you that, you know, don't feel obligated to give anything during this service. We just hope that this service is a gift which is actually given back to you. If there's something that you would like to put in the giving plate, it could be a connecting card, which is in the seat back in front of you, where we could collect some information to introduce ourselves and continue the conversation with you. But if you are a member here and you call LBC your church family, we would ask that you give and give generously as the Lord instructs us in his word. A couple things just to draw to your attention. We are getting near Thanksgiving. It is on the horizon, and with that comes our annual Thanksgiving service project called the Adopt a Bag. And so you'll notice out in the lobby, there's a table with a lot of bags in it. And so what we do every year is we fill those bags with Thanksgiving food and a gift card to purchase a turkey or a ham, and we deliver them to needy families around Monmouth County, particularly in the Bayshore area. And we are going to stretch our commitment for this year. Last year, we collected and filled 103 bags for families in the Bayshore, and this year, we're going to partner with the Rain Foundation, which is a nonprofit out of Hazlitt, and we're going to partner with Brookdale Community College to commit to filling 140 bags and delivering them. And so this is an opportunity to build bridges into the community, to get to know our neighbors, to pray with them, have spiritual conversations, and most importantly, point them to Jesus. So what I would ask of you is to consider taking a bag, maybe even two, and filling it. But if you take a bag, that's a commitment to our community, and we're counting on you to fill it and return it to us, because if we don't get enough, then we're not able to meet our commitment to the community, and that would be, you know, a bad thing. So we would just ask you, if you take a bag, please fill it please return it. And also consider, you know, maybe even being a delivery driver for us and getting out in the community and being Jesus' hands and feet around Thanksgiving. So that's one of the major things that's coming up on our horizon over the next coming weeks. Typically, we spend part of our service confessing our sins together, but it is important not only to confess our sins, but to confess and testify to the common faith that the Christian church has held since the time of the apostles. Throughout church history, the church has gotten together and crafted statements which summarize and articulate the truths of Scripture. And today, we're going to be reciting together the Nicene Creed. This creed was finalized in 380 AD. So we belong to an ancient faith with ancient roots. I'm going to lead us in a responsive reading, and the slides which say leader, I will read by myself, and then we can all read the underlying slides, the slides that say all together as we confess what we believe as Christians. And so we'll read the Nicene Creed together. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, begotten from the Father, before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of the same essence as the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. He became incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made human. And he was crucified for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again with glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will never end. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life. He proceeds from the Father and the Son, and with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified. He spoke through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We affirm one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look forward to the resurrection of the dead and to life in the world to come. Amen. What you just recited unites us with previous generations of Christians across thousands of years. Christians who have held fast to the faith delivered once for all. And what you're about to witness will unite us to the future generations as we dedicate our children today and commit to passing the faith on to the next generation. Here at LBC, it's our hope that every child in our church will be transformed by the gospel, that each and every child will come to a saving relationship with Jesus Christ, who died to release his people from their sins and rose again on the third day, being victorious over Satan, sin, and death. Therefore, as a church, we desire to come alongside you as parents to make disciples of the next generation. Psalm 127 says, "Children are a gift from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward." Children are precious. They're precious in the sight of God, and we should view them as a gift. Ephesians 6:2 says, "Do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord." Children are given to us by God with the tremendous responsibility to teach them the ways of the Lord. The goal of Christian parenting is to share Jesus with our children and set an example for them in godly living. And so this morning, I would like to invite up the families who have come to dedicate their children to the Lord.
At this time, I would invite you to stand as we continue to worship through song. This next song that we're going to sing is new this week. I came across this 2 weeks ago, and the first time I listened through it, I just felt refreshed by the Spirit of the Lord encouraging me through the lyrics of these songs. So as we sing it, I would encourage you to join in if you feel comfortable with the melody, but if not, please just listen to the words as we sing them and allow the Spirit of the Lord to work in your heart and encourage you through these words. So this is a song called Sing to Jesus. Seated.
Good morning. Can everybody hear me? Good morning. My name is Ina Prizwara, and I serve in women's ministry here at Lincroft Bible Church. Today's scripture reading is Psalm 16 in the English Standard Version. You can find this excerpt printed in today's bulletin. Please join me in reading and hearing God's word. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my God. Or you are my Lord, sorry. I have no good apart from you. As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those who run after another god shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also, my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I shall not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. This is God's word.
Good morning, church. I say that because it's supposed to be Kachung up here today, and that's the way he always starts. My name is Dave Heimitz. I'm also an elder here at church. And unlike Jeff last week, I am not of the tucked-in shirt side. I am the untucked shirt side. Still believe I can be up front and do that. Will you pray with me? Father God, we do just thank you for being our Lord and our God, for being the rock, the cornerstone on which this church is built. We thank you, Lord, that we can come before you, that we can lay our concerns and cares before you. We thank you that you are a God who loves us, and you have demonstrated that love to us by giving us your Son, Jesus. Lord, we thank you that we have the ability to pray, to come before you, to talk to you, knowing that you love us, that you care for us, and Lord, that those prayers are answered. We thank you for the gift of answered prayers. We thank you that we've seen this just this morning and all the children that have been born to us over this recent times, Lord. And just, I thank you for your grace that have brought these families to this point, Lord. Lord, I thank you for the answered prayers of being with them through the pregnancies and the deliveries, Lord. Lord, I thank you for the answered prayers of seeing us through difficult times in the past and through seeing us as we've gone, guiding us as we've gone through this pandemic, Lord. Lord, I thank you that you are a God who loves us, that you're concerned with every portion of our lives, Lord, and that you desire to come before you on a regular basis. Lord, I just pray for our church here. I pray for the different ministries that are going on, Lord. I pray for the men as they are away this weekend on the men's retreat. I thank you for the time that we had there, Lord, time to draw closer to you, time to draw closer to one another. Lord, I also just lift up the children's ministry that's going on down the hall. I pray for the leaders there, the teachers there. I pray that you use that time, that you use those kids, that you use, Lord, the words that are spoken there to draw those children closer to you. Lord, I also just praise you and thank you, as your word said, that we should rejoice in the difficult times that we go through. Lord, there are so many things that come our way, and when they're difficult, Lord, it just forces us to come before you, just casting our anxieties upon you because we know that you love us. Lord, I pray for those in this congregation that are not well health-wise. Lord, I pray for those that are unemployed or underemployed, Lord. I pray for those that are going through difficulties within their marriage or within their family. Lord, all these concerns, you care for us, you love us, and I just cast them all on you. Lord, I just pray that you continue to guide us here as leadership of this church. I pray that you continue to pour out your wisdom on us through your Spirit, through your word, that you guide us as we move forward, teaching us to be a church that knows how to love well. Lord, this morning I just pray for Dan as he comes to speak to us, Lord. I ask that you use him as your vessel, that you speak through him, Lord, that you allow our hearts to be open to your word, that in that your word changes us, Lord, and draws us closer to you. And Lord, I just pray all these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Well, I didn't know the tucked-in shirt thing was going to become a church rivalry, but, you know, I guess there's more petty things than that. Good morning. Glad to have you here this morning. You know, sometimes my family and I, we play this game called Would You Rather. Have you ever played this? Right? Would you rather? It can be downright funny. So some of my favorite are, would you rather have an extra set of eyes on the tips of your fingers or the back of your head? How many tips of the fingers, people? You could see me better if you hold your hand up, right? Or would you rather have breakfast for dinner or dinner for breakfast every day for the rest of your life? Thinking about it, right? So there's a range of would you rather questions that we can ask, and sometimes it's downright hilarious, but sometimes it gets a lot more serious than that. And one serious would you rather question that I encountered recently as I was spending time with God was this question: would you rather have a mountaintop experience without God or be in the valley of the shadow of death with God? Would you rather have a mountaintop experience without God or be in the valley of the shadow of death with God? Now, if you're anything like me, sometimes we have these more honest moments with our own heart where we recognize, I know what I should say, I know what I want to say, I know what I want to say, but in actuality, if I'm really honest with myself, and in that moment I was, I would rather have the mountain without God than to have the valley with God. And that's a hard truth to admit. Because when it comes down to it, sometimes in our heart of hearts, as much as we like to say we love God or follow God or believe in God, what we really would rather have is a life of painless existence or a life of relatively little pain than to have a life of pain but have God the whole time. And what that cuts at the core, I think, above all else, is the question of, do we really love God? And do we really love God for God? I know that's a hard question for me to answer, and that's a question that we'll be addressing in our series as we begin our series this morning in a selection of Psalms. The series is entitled Behold Your God, and what we want to do over the next several weeks is actually look at what God is like as we see him revealed in the Psalms. I love the book of Psalms. The Psalms is really the song book or the prayer book of the people of God, and the Psalms show us the beauty and loveliness of God in a way that very little else does. It captures the range of human emotions, and so for many of us who believe in God, who've walked with God for a long time, the Psalms have been especially dear to us. And if you're like me, there's some that are especially dear because they speak to your heart in a way that maybe others don't. And Psalm 16 is one of those Psalms that we're going to look at this morning. So if you have your Bible or the Bible in front of you, your smartphone, open up your Bible to Psalm chapter 16. And as we go there, we're remembering the question as we think about as a church that we want to love well. We need to love God well, but we can't love what we don't know. The quote we've said several times along the way is, the heart cannot love what the mind does not know. And perhaps one of the reasons that you don't love God as much as you would like to love God is you don't know God as well as you think you do. And this morning, as we look at Psalm 16, this has been a psalm that's been a comfort and a source of encouragement for Christians down through the ages. And this is really a psalm of confidence that's expressing confidence in the character of God. If we could boil this one psalm of 11 verses down into one sentence, we could say it this way: it invites you to put your confidence and satisfaction in God, and you will not be disappointed. Put your confidence and satisfaction in God, and you will not be disappointed. But disappointment's common to life, isn't it? I mean, I'm sure that you've experienced disappointment in many ways this week, maybe even this morning. Disappointment's something that we all deal with. We struggle in many ways because life just does not bend the way that we would like it to. I'm willing to bet that you experience and deal with discontentment because that is my experience as well. The fact is, discontentment runs deep. I don't know about you, but maybe through the course of the last year and a half, like me, you've experienced times where objectively everything in your life was okay. But if you were really honest, you just weren't happy. I found myself often surprised at my own life this year as I've looked and said, nothing is really wrong, but I'm just not happy. And maybe that's your story as well. If you have felt that way or you feel that way this morning, then Psalm 16 is a psalm for you. And if anyone could have had the right to be discontent, it was David, the one who authors this psalm. And when he wrote this psalm, he was a refugee on the run from King Saul. You may remember we did the Life of David series a number of weeks back, and David was a fugitive. He had been promised the kingdom. He had been promised all of these blessings, and yet Saul, the reigning king, was after him and looking to kill him. So David's on the run, no home, no inheritance, no security, no guarantees, no one he's certain he can trust, and no place consistently to lay his head. If anybody could have justly complained to God, it would have been David. He had an understandably discontent situation, but David, rather than voicing a complaint, we see, actually sings with confidence about the character of God, and that's what this psalm is about. It's a song of confidence. It's a song of a refugee who has no shelter and no refuge, but has found shelter and refuge in God. And so it invites us this morning to put our confidence and satisfaction in God so that we won't be disappointed. Pain has a way of kind of shaking our confidence. When we experience pain, it causes us to doubt God's goodness, God's love, and God's care. But while David is experiencing those doubts and experiencing a life of pain, he expresses three different confidences in the character of God. And that's kind of how the psalm is broken down. Three different expressions of confidence in God's character that anchor his soul in God's love. And maybe they'll anchor yours as well. Here's the first expression of confidence. That is that God is a refuge. God is a refuge. You know, when my kids were little, they needed to be redirected from danger, not to run into the street, and so I would take them by the hand and walk them back to safety. And in a similar way, what David actually does is he takes us by the hand and shows us where we find safety. We see that in verse 1 where he prays, "Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge." In other words, the refugee knows that he has God as a refuge. He may have no circumstantial safety, but what he does with his pain is he brings it to God because he knows that in God he is safe. This is what it means for God to be our refuge. It means that God is a place of safety and protection for his children. And so he cries out to God, and having God as his refuge gives him great confidence. Verse 2, he says, "I say to the Lord, you are my Lord, and apart from you, I have no good thing." I think we can imagine how David feels. You can imagine just wanting to have a place to call home, just to be surrounded by a few people who you know love you and whom you can trust to feel safe at night. And it's easy in times of insecurity and pain, when the circumstances are uncertain, to doubt God's goodness. But David acknowledges that God is his Lord, his King, and that ultimately, apart from God, he is no good thing. And so what's happening here is David is in the midst of a terrible circumstance. He recognizes that objectively speaking in his life, things are not good, but because he has God, something is good. And he recognizes that any good he does have comes ultimately from the goodness of God. Any shelter, any security, any rest comes from the hand of God. And without God, he says, ultimately he has no good thing. And this is the teaching of the scriptures as a whole. The book of James actually says that every good gift and every perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variation or shadow of turning. The Bible tells us that God makes it rain on the evil and on the good. Every good that we experience, a beautiful day, a smile, a friendship, every good in life ultimately comes from the hand of God. You don't have to be religious to believe that, but that's a true reality. That's why hell is such a bad reality, because it's ultimately the removal from everything that is good in God. And so David is recognizing, listen, apart from you, God, I have no good thing. That the good life is not situated in good circumstances, but the good life is situated in the goodness of God. And so David affirms with trust, God is my refuge, he is my place of safety and protection. Apart from him, I have no ultimate good. Maybe you've had the experience, I've gotten this advice before, when you go to a new place, you don't really know which way you're supposed to go, and maybe it's been told you don't have to know what you're doing, just act like you do. And I did this one time. I was going, and I don't even remember the place I was going, but I'm like, all right, I don't know where anything is, but I'm just going to pretend like I do, and I'm washing my hands, and I realized somebody else came out, I'm in the wrong room. Have you ever had this experience? I don't know actually whether I was in the wrong room or she was in the wrong room, but one of us was, and feigning confidence got me into the wrong place, the women's bathroom. Some of you didn't pick that up already. But feigning confidence is no real way to live because it doesn't actually provide any real security. David is not feigning confidence. He has real confidence in God because his security is really found in God. In verse 3 and 4, what he does is contrast. There's two ways to live in order to pursue security in life. One way to live is what he says he does is he finds his delight. He identifies with the people of God. They are the ones in whom is all my delight. because he realizes that to run with those who are running after other gods is not a good way to live. Look at verse 4. He says, "The sorrows of those who run after another god shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips." What David is really saying is this: if you chase idols, you choose sorrow. An idol is anything that takes a god's rightful place. It's looking to a good thing and making it a god thing. It's looking to a gift from God and asking it to be the giver of life. It's looking to something, some person, some entity, some reality to give you life, security, and deliverance. And David's saying, if you chase after that, you choose a life of sorrow. But in reality, we all end up often chasing idols because in pain there's a great pull and temptation to look to something or some person as a way of escape. We look to something to say, if I have you, then I'll be okay. But what David is saying is that although an idol may promise good rescue and comfort, ultimately it will bite you. If you look to an idol for satisfaction, your sorrows won't be drowned out, but you'll drown in them. Maybe you've experienced this with something like work before, right? Work is a good thing created by God for good and for blessing. But oftentimes, work promises that if we work just a little bit harder and a little bit more, we can make a little bit more money, have a little bit more security, and things will be better in our life, right? We have all bought into this narrative one time or another. But ultimately, what we find is that oftentimes we give ourselves then to overwork, and we find ourselves swirling and drowning in the sea of work that just continues to mount and amplify, and we need more of it in order to have more money and more security, or we need more of it to validate our existence. And what actually happens is we're proving what David says is true, is I chase an idol, I choose sorrow. It ends up multiplying in my life. Because when you look to an idol for satisfaction, it's like looking to a parasite, hoping that you will draw life from it, and then being surprised that it's sucking the life out of you. The fact is, none of us can avoid pain in life. But David shows us that when God is our refuge, while we can't subtract pain from our life, we can avoid multiplying pain in our life. And so I wonder about you this morning. What are you looking to for security? What are you looking to and saying, if I have you, then I'll be happy and secure? What are you looking to and saying, you can be my refuge, from you I'll draw life? We have to be honest with ourselves, it might not be God. Is God your refuge? Is he the place of safety that you run to when you need to secure more stability for yourself in life? Have you made God your Lord? That's what David ultimately says. God is my refuge, but he's his refuge because he has made him his Lord. He has made him his king. He has let God be God and be in charge of his life. And so maybe this morning you're looking at your life and you're running exhausted and you're choking on your own fumes. But David shows us that even people like you and me, even refugees, can find a refuge in God. But we find a refuge ultimately in God when we stop running after other gods and run to God instead. That's what it's really like to become a Christian. It's not just to become religious. It's not just to try to find a way to escape from pain. It's not just a way to go to heaven when you die, but it's a place of safety here and now that lasts forever. And that place of safety transcends the pain in life. It's a deep confidence that even though everything is crumbling all around you, even though your circumstances are shifting and you have no sense of stability around you, that God's got you because he makes you secure. David says, God is my Lord. He is my refuge. And I'd rather run for my life with him than ruin my life running after other gods without him. Would you say that for yourself? But there's another expression of confidence in the psalm that David gives. He doesn't just say that God is my refuge. He also says in verse 5 that God is his portion. When I used to go on away trips for football in college, we used to travel and we'd have these two big buses and we'd pull up to the Golden Corral. Has anybody ever been to one of these places? I don't know if they have them in New Jersey. We have finer tastes here. But at that point in college, this was like gold. It was like finding gold. Man, those rolls. Those were so good because in college, when I played football, I used to judge a restaurant quality by the quantity of food that I can consume, right? By the portion size on the plate. Now, as I get older, that's still true. But when it comes to God as our portion, we're not talking about quality, we're talking about quantity. And David recognizes, that's not what is right. not quantity, but quality as it relates to God. You guys are smart. You understood what I meant. And as David pens this song with confidence, he believes that in God he has all he needs. Look at verse 5. He says, "The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance." Now, David's a fugitive on the run, but he says that he has a beautiful inheritance. Now, these concepts might not seem significant to us, but for the people who originally sang them, they were a clear reference to the Israelites inheriting the promised land. When God brought his people into the promised land, each tribe was given an allotment, a portion. They were given boundary lines where they would set up their property, much like we have surveys set up today. This is our property. This is our allotment of land. And David is saying, although I have no place to call my head, my home, no place to lay my head, God is my portion. He is my allotment. He is my inheritance. And what he's actually doing is he's identifying with the tribe of Levi, the priests of Israel, who actually had no inheritance. They were to say, as it says in Deuteronomy 18, "The Lord is my portion." Because they were dedicated to the Lord, God himself would be their reward. God himself would be their portion. And David is saying, "I'm with them. God is my portion. He is my inheritance." And this is what David saying is essentially this: I've got nothing by way of inheritance. I've lost it all. It's all been taken from me. I'm supposed to be the king, to have a land, a palace, and a family. But circumstantially, while I have nothing, I still have everything because God is all I ever need or want. He's a vagabond, a fugitive, and a refugee, but he says he has a beautiful inheritance. And so while he may feel abandoned, he may feel like things are unstable, unsure, and uncertain, he is certain of one thing, that because he has God, he has everything that he needs. I wonder if you feel that way. You know, here's the thing I think I've realized, that often there's a huge gap between our situation and our satisfaction. There's a huge gap between our situation and our satisfaction. But if God is our portion, he is the one who fills the gap between our situation and our satisfaction. And if God is your portion, you can have satisfaction ultimately regardless of your situation. If God is your portion, you can have satisfaction regardless of your situation. Maybe you remember the story in the Bible of Mary and Martha, two sisters who were friends of Jesus. And one time Jesus came to their house, and he was there and he was teaching, and Martha was busy serving in the kitchen to make a nice meal for Jesus. And Mary is sitting there at Jesus' feet listening to Jesus teach. And Martha is not happy. You remember the story. Martha is not happy because Mary should be helping her get the food ready. And she complains to Jesus. "Jesus, tell her, help me." And Jesus says, "Martha, Martha, Mary has chosen the good portion, and that will not be taken from her." Mary has chosen the good portion because she has chosen Jesus, and that will not be taken from her. And David is expressing a similar thing. "I've chosen God. He is the good portion. Situationally, I may have nothing, but I have him, and that cannot be taken away from me." So I wonder today, friend, what need is there in your life that Jesus is not sufficient for? What longing do you have that Jesus isn't enough to satisfy? What thirst do you have that Jesus isn't enough to quench? The Apostle Peter tells us in 2 Peter that we have everything that we need for life and godliness through the knowledge of him. Do you believe that you have everything that you need in Jesus? David ultimately does, and so he sings with confidence because he's chosen to make God his portion. In verse 7, we see him worshiping. He says, "I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me." What he's doing is worshiping, and as he worships, his doubts about God's goodness start to diminish. Did you hear that? As he worships, his doubts about God's goodness start to diminish. As he worships, his heart begins to fill with confidence. And maybe you've had this experience before. I know that I have. Oftentimes, we doubt God loves us. Our situation is not good. And maybe we actually are listening to a worship song. We're going for a walk. I know sometimes I put my earbuds in and I'm walking. And all of a sudden, as I'm singing, as I'm worshiping, the doubts about God's goodness begin to diminish. And the reality about who he is and how much he loves me begins to amplify. This was a psalmist in Psalm. This is what Psalm 73 is about. We're not going to do this in our teaching series, but the worship leader in Israel is upset because it seems that while he's doing the right thing, all the people who are doing the wrong thing are prospering. And he's upset about it. And he says, "Then I remembered their fate when I went into the house of the Lord." In other words, as he begins to worship, his perspective begins to change. His doubts about God's goodness begin to diminish. And he ends that psalm on a high note. He says, "Whom have I in heaven but you? You are the strength of my life and my portion forever." How do you get there? Worship. And as you worship God, your doubts about God begin to diminish. David doesn't say this is a passive thing. Believing that God is his portion didn't just happen to him one day. He didn't have an epiphany. This happened because he set his eyes on the Lord. Look at verse 8. "I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken." In other words, David learned to look off and away from himself, off and away from his circumstances, and off and away to God. The NIV states it this way, "I keep my eyes always on the Lord." I wonder, do you want confidence in life? The way to confidence is to keep looking at Christ. Love the words of Robert Murray McShane, who said, "For every one look at yourself, take 10 looks off and away to Jesus." David has unshakable confidence in a shaky situation because he has set God continually before him. And when you set God before you, you can have confidence that God is beside you. Are you with me? When you set God before you, you can have confidence that God is beside you. And that's what David says. "Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken." And so here's the application for you and me today. We become like what we look at. We learn to love what we look at repeatedly. When I first married Emily, my wife, I thought she was beautiful. Now, 11 years later, to do the math real quick, 11 years later, I find that she's way more beautiful than I could ever have imagined. But like a diamond, as you experience life with somebody, you see the multifaceted beauty of what makes up a person. As I've looked at her for the last 11 years, she's become increasingly beautiful to me. She may have been that already, and I just didn't see it. But as I've looked at her and gazed at her, she's become more beautiful. It's the same but better with God. When we behold God in all of his beauty, when we stare into the face of Christ, as 2 Corinthians 3 says, as into a mirror, we're being transformed from one degree to another. Do you know why we're so shaken in life? Why we're so discontent? Could it not be because we're beholding endless advertisements and images that are telling us, "I will only be happy if"? As a pastor, let me just be honest, one of the most demoralizing realities is I'll stand up here and preach for longer than you want to hear every week. But regardless, you're still only in here for an hour and a half every week. But every one of us is consuming at least 20 hours of formative content a week. How can we compete with that? How can we compete with endless hours of entertainment that parades as news, of fantasy football, of Instagram and Facebook, that's telling us you will only be happy if you have this? We become like, and we learn to love what we look at repeatedly. Now, I'm not down on those things. What I'm down on is down on people ruining their lives by looking at screens instead of at Jesus. I'm not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, but I do know that when we run after other gods, it ruins our life rather than restores us. And so here's the point then. We're not going to love God deeply unless we learn to look deeply into his face. But if we do, this is the hope piece, if we do, we'll find that like David, God can satisfy us in a way that nothing else can. So here's the question for you this week. How will you get more looks at Jesus? How you get more looks at Jesus? How will you set the Lord before you this week? Maybe you actually literally put this verse on your TV screen. Maybe actually set some boundaries. Maybe actually turn off the Facebook or turn off the screen for a week, and you say, "I'm going to get more looks at Jesus," and see what that does. Just test it. Test it out. Try it and see what it does for your soul. No one would blame David for complaining, and maybe no one would blame you because your circumstances are legitimately not good. But when we know God as refuge and as portion, we can have confidence. And David shows us that there's one more expression of confidence in God's character that anchors us to God's love, and that is that he says that God is my joy. God is my joy. Let me ask you this. When was the last time you felt insecure? Maybe insecure about where you stood with the friend, with your spouse, maybe insecure when you walked in this morning. You didn't know where to go, and so you hopefully didn't end up in the wrong bathroom like I did. And you wonder, will anybody talk to me? Will anybody love me? If they knew me, will they accept me? We all feel insecure. And insecurity, whether real or perceived, has a way of robbing us of joy. And when you're not sure if you're loved and accepted, and you're not sure where you're going to lay your head or how the bills are going to be paid tomorrow, can lead to great discontentment. But David expresses a sense of confidence, a sense of joy that probably eludes most of us. Note in verse 9 what he says. Notice, though, his circumstances hasn't changed, but his heart has. He's confident that God is his refuge, and so he says, "Therefore, my heart is glad, and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure." How can a fugitive say this? How can a refugee say this? His circumstances are garbage, but his heart is glad. Think about for a moment his tired, anxious, fearful fugitive expressing deep contentment in God that apparently his terrible circumstances can't touch. And he's expressing an inner gladness that the outer madness of the world just cannot reach. He's expressing an inner gladness that the sadness of life can't quite touch. In other words, while his world around him is shaking inwardly, he has a deep sense of security in the love of God. When you think about your life, does that describe your life? The world shaking around you, but inwardly you are secure in the love of God. But David ratchets it up a notch. On the one hand, he's confident that God's got him in life. Verse 9, my flesh will dwell secure. But he also trusts that if God loves him, he'll protect him not only in this life, but also in the life to come. Look what he says in verse 10. For you, God, will not abandon my soul to Sheol or the realm of the dead, or let your Holy One see corruption. Now, I'm sure there were times in life where David doubted, just like you and I do, where he felt abandoned by God. But here he's rehearsing truth, and he knows deep down that no matter what happens in life, no matter how hard or painful it gets, even if he dies, God's got him. And if God's got you, then nothing can get you. He knows not only will God preserve him in death, but he has confidence that God will actually take him to life. Verse 11, the high point of the psalm, you make known to me the path of life, and in your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand pleasures forevermore. Here's what's amazing. David can look at his miserable situation, and I think you have a miserable situation this morning too, and he can look at that with all the insecurity and the uncertainty, and he can say with faith, I know God's got me. And I have a joy, a contentment in God that my circumstances can't touch. And even if I die, you know what's on the other side of that? Endless joy. Isn't that amazing? But here's what's even more amazing than that. David is expressing this confidence in God, and he doesn't even know how it's possible. He's just banking on what he knows to be true about the character of God. But for us and where we stand today on this side of redemptive history, we see that the psalm really only makes sense because of Jesus. In fact, the New Testament writers, both Peter and Paul, actually quote this psalm regarding the resurrection. Peter, in his Pentecost sermon, says that God did not abandon Jesus to death. And Paul says in Acts 13, preaching of the eternal joy that comes to us only in Jesus. And so while David's trusting the character of God, we actually can look back with this psalm with confidence, a different kind of soul security because of who Jesus is. We can be confident way more than David is. How much more true this psalm is for us who are in Christ. You see, we can have joy now in the midst of difficult circumstances because we know that God will not abandon us, and he's proven it. We don't have to be abandoned to the death that we deserve because God the Father abandoned Jesus, who didn't deserve it. You see, it was on the cross that Jesus was abandoned by the Father. This is what is happening when Jesus cries, my God, why have you forsaken me? Is there any more abandonment than that? Jesus cried out in agony as he plunged into the depth of hell, as he was abandoned by God so that we could be dwelling secure. But God didn't ultimately let Jesus see corruption. He didn't let Jesus' body decay in the grave. Jesus didn't stay dead, but he rose again 3 days later. And God did not abandon him forever, but God raised him to life and showed him the path of life so that all who would repent and trust in him would not perish, but have eternal life. In other words, Jesus paves the path to eternal life. He was the first to taste and experience the endless joy at the right hand of God, and he offers to any who would trust in him that that same joy. The scripture tells us that Jesus is leading many sons to glory, which means he's taking with him into his presence at his right hand where there's fullness of joy any who would stop running after other gods and run to him in faith instead. What that means for you is that there's eternal joy available to you. It means that we don't have to go to hell anymore. If God didn't let Jesus see corruption and God didn't abandon Jesus to the realm of the dead, then he won't let that happen to you either if you trust in Christ. Can we get any more secure than that? And think about this then. If God won't abandon you in death, will he abandon you in life? No, God's got you like it is by the scruff of the neck, and there's nothing that anyone can do to snatch you out of his hand. Jesus says, "My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand." And so we can sing with confidence, "O love that will not let me go, I dare not ask to fly from thee." Where else can we go? So let's think about this then. What do we do with our doubts? Our doubts are real. And this week you may doubt God's love and care for you because of your circumstances and your pain. You might look and you say, "I'm a fugitive. I have no home. I have no security. I might die tomorrow." Or maybe more real for you, "My kids hate me, my spouse resents me, finances are falling apart, I'm jobless, friendless, and hopeless." And we think in those moments, "Man, God must really hate me. Or at least he stopped loving me." But we doubt because we drift. We start looking around us or we start looking within us and we ultimately drift from his love. It's like being in the ocean in the summer. We find ourselves playing for a while, and all of a sudden we realize we're halfway down the shore. We have no idea how we got there. What do we do? Well, Jesus tells us, if we want fullness of joy, we need to abide in his love. John 15, he says, "Abide in my love so that your joy may be full." Jesus says, in essence, camp out in my love. Camp out in front of the cross. Make your tent, make your dwelling there. What do when we feel insecure about God's love, when we doubt that he cares for us? We pitch our tent in the love of God. The key to David's confidence wasn't a pep talk. It wasn't showing up to church more or doing more religious things. It was that he set the Lord always before him. And he says with confidence, "Because he's at my right hand, I will not be shaken." And so friends, I want you to know that when you doubt God's love this week, you can know that he loves you. You can know that you're secure in his love because he has proven it. And if you want proof of his love, you need to look no further than the cross. He's proven his love for you by dying for you, and he loved you enough to die. And if he loved you enough to die for you, then he certainly loves you enough to hold on to you. So think on these things when you doubt this week. Abide in his love so that your joy may be full. What would you rather have? Mountaintop without God, valley of death with God. We all want a life of ease and comfort, a life free from pain. But my prayer is that we as a church would say with the old hymn, "I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today." So as we think about what it means to love well as a church, we need to love God deeply. But the only way we will love God deeply is if we plunge ourselves into the depth of his love. We can't love a God we don't know, and David's confidence, and ours can come from this too, comes in knowing the character of God. He is my refuge, he is my portion, and he is my joy. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have sent your son Jesus to be the Savior of the world. We thank you that you did not let his body see decay, but that you showed him the path of life, and that in his presence there is fullness of joy and eternal pleasures forevermore. Father, we confess our weakness, that we often are doubting and unbelieving, that we're often looking around us at our circumstances and we feel uncertain and insecure. But with you, there is security. You are our refuge. You are our portion. You are enough for us, and you can be our true joy. We pray that that would be true for us this week. In Jesus, our Savior's name, we pray. Amen.
Would you please stand with us as we sing?
having nothing from a life of worldly passion.
We end every service with a benediction, which is a blessing for the road. Hear this from Lamentations chapter 3. The mercies of the Lord are new every morning. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I have hope in him. You are sent.